So good evening to all of you and welcome to this session. And our topic today is a woman's work, the personal and the professional. So when you think of a woman's work, what image comes to your mind generally? It would be probably a woman who has a million hands, who is doing a million different tasks, right? So in fact, I would like to share a nice poem with you, which was written by Maya Angelou, and it was published in 1978. But it resonates with women even today. So I'll just recite a few lines from that poem. I've got children to tend, the cloths to mend, the floor to mop, the food to shop, then the chicken to fry, the baby to dry. I got company to feed, the garden to weed. I've got shirts to press, the tots to dress, the can to be cut. I got to clean up this hut, then see about the sick and the cotton to pick. So I thought it'd be a good idea to extend this poem to today's women and see what the women of today do. Let's see what the women of today do. I've got a plane to fly and a tank to ride. I've got a case to ace and a film to make. I've got a boss to please and targets to meet. I've got a CEO to coach and taboo subjects to broach. I've got a project to win and storyboards to pin. And yet I've got the children to tend and the cloths to mend. So you can see how much more women have taken over these years. So much of multitasking, so much of juggling, doing the tightrope walk. So my first question would be to Manisha. Manisha, in your book, From Saris to Stripes, you said that pilots have no gender. While in your professional life, you could say that you know, pilots have no gender, but you've also played gender-specific roles as a mother, a wife, a daughter. So in your career or in your life, did you ever feel that you probably have to make a choice between the personal and the professional?
Good evening to you all. And thank you, Sajita, for beautifully introducing us with the juggling through your lovely poetry. Each word was very meaningful. And yes, I'm sure all of us sitting here, including the audience, and I see a lot of women, wear all hats, whether it's that of a daughter, daughter-in-law, mother, wife, sister, and yet we are ourselves what we are. My profession being high-flight profession, or you can say being in the air, 33,000 feet, once you've left the ground, there's no way to connect. No phone calls, no internet. I would say no disturbance, actually. It's beautifully quiet and wonderful in that cockpit. Believe me, when your stress try go up in the air, it's, you know, relaxing. And cockpit is anyway beautiful. That's my office. And, you know, the lovely huge windows around. And I assure you, the best sunrise, best sunset you'll never see anywhere in the world. You can go wherever and spend all your money, come up in the air, and you have it all. So having a profession like this, it was not very easy to juggle. I mean, it was smooth sailing till you were not married. And suddenly when you decided and you had kids, I'll just narrate a small incident. I was in command, quite new in command, and I had my two little babies who were small, two girls. I packed them up nicely, got them ready. They went into the park to play, and I reached the airport. It was a bad day. My aircraft has numerous snags. It took me nearly 2 hours to get everything all sorted out before the flight got delayed. Got airborne, faced through the worst turbulent weather throughout Delhi to Bangalore. And, you know, kind of made a smooth touchdown and landed midnight. Home around 3 PM, landed midnight. And as I switched on my phone, I see 5 missed calls from home. And I'm wondering what, everything was so smooth when I left. And sure enough, before I reached the hotel, my husband calls and he says, you know, the little one fell and she's, I think something's wrong with her hand. She's crying. And I've tried putting in a crepe bandage, but it's no good. And I said, if it's swollen, open the crepe bandage. She's broken her arm. Take her to the doctor first thing, got an x-ray done. And that moment, you are miles apart. and you wonder whether your little baby, who is just about 5 years old, wants you to hug her, get her out of her pain with your love and affection, and I'm sitting here. So the thoughts do come in, and you don't know whether, you know, you're really playing the right role being what you are. But then juggling is what that teaches us in the profession. Yes, you have emergencies, you need to deal with it. And so head on, get them out, be there. So every step you take it in that positive way. And I would also say support from family, and I'm sure all of you agree, at least in my profession, the family support helps you come out of these little hiccups. And so we continued, and women have been flying since the 1966. Please go have a look at this book, From Saris to Stripes, and you'll realize flying commercial airlines, not one quit because of marriage or kids. We managed beautifully, and it does help. The profession does give you that strength. And we do manage to bring up my daughter sitting here. You can ask her whether she had a good time mother flying or not. Thank you.
So that, I'm sure, Manisha, you're talking about a lot of mental strength there to be able to balance both your personal and your professional lives. So now talking about mental strength, let me ask this to Anvita. She's a beauty queen, and she's written this wonderful book called Beauty Queen, The Pathway to Pageantry. And she's written that a beauty queen needs to have mental strength. Now, this is not something what we usually associate with beauty queens, the mental strength aspect. So could you tell us something about that aspect of pageantry?
You know, it's actually a very gross misconception that glamorous industries don't require hard work, don't require perseverance, and don't require strength of personality or of mind or of anything of that sort. Talking about pageants very specifically, first of all, when you're an aspirant, when you're training yourself, when you want to get there, you have to do everything by yourself. Usually it takes a team to get a person to look the way they need to look to be on that international stage. Whether it's a Harna Sandhu who's just won, or if it's a Sushmita Sen, it takes a team. It takes a whole army of people doing your hair, doing your makeup, if someone's in charge of your outfits. It takes a team to make you look that way. But when you're participating, you are on your own. You have to take care of everything yourself. Plus, you have to take care of yourself. You have to take care of how you, when you wake up, you have to make your own food. You're on your own, like in any other industry, like in any other place. When you're in a pageant, it's a different ball game altogether. You do have people taking care of certain things for you, but at the same time, you're pushed in a completely different direction. Training periods start at 5:30 in the morning and they only end at 2:30 at night. You're rehearsing, you're in front of the press, you have to perform well, you have to have your A game up the whole time, otherwise you're not going to win. It is all about public appearances. And that does take a lot of, it does take a toll on your mind. Once you win, that's the third ballgame. Because now, technically speaking, you are a star. But that doesn't make it any easier. If anything, it only makes things much harder. Because A, you achieve this at the age of 19 or 20 or 21 or something of that sort. Once again, I'm going to bring the reference back to Harna Sandhu because she's just won Miss Universe. She's a 21-year-old girl from Chandigarh. It's not easy. Now she's being shuttled to New York. She has to live on her own. She's being catapulted into the world of glamour. She's going to be the face of India at New York Fashion Week, at Paris Fashion Week, at Tokyo Fashion Week. She's going to be hobnobbing with the who's who of every industry in the world. And she has to hold her own. That's not easy either. So there are very few professions that are actually easy, to be very honest. And they all take mental strength. They all take the same skills at a certain level.
Right.
Pageantry is no different.
Wonderful insights there, Anvita. And I'm never going to ask another beauty queen this question about mental strength. I totally understand it now. All right. So, Aparna, now we come to you and let's discuss your book. In your book, The Professional Women's Handbook, you mentioned that women often settle for less. So why is that? Why do you say that women often settle for less? What is the less that they are settling for? And why does that happen? Is it because of women's mental conditioning or anything else?
Yeah, it's probably a combination of several things. And I think I mentioned this in the context of the chapter around work and career, if I'm not mistaken, where I ended it with, you know, God forbid she, you know, people think she's ambitious or, you know, she has a goal for herself. Oh my God. So one is this whole, the way we've been brought up, the way women are generally socialized is to be more nurturing, taking care of others' needs, you know, looking after the family, and good girls need to be quiet and, you know, bring others up, put others first before yourself, which are wonderful values. Yeah, they're wonderful values. But nowhere have we been taught about thinking about our own goals. What is it we want to do in life, right? So as we grow up, two things happen. One is we think it is the right thing to do to kind of move back, shrink ourselves in a sense, and try and manage, you know, so many other needs. So Manisha was talking about that incident about where her daughter, you know, fell down, right? And I mean, it's a personal example that I'm kind of twisting a little bit. Apologies, Manisha, but imagine your husband were the pilot. Yeah, and you were at home and your daughter fell down. You would have handled it.
Absolutely.
You would not have made 5 calls. You know, that level of self-sufficiency exists, right? And it happens. But somehow, you know, if a woman is working, those calls come. And you're living with that pressure throughout. Yes. It's not something that goes away at all. Yeah. One of the reasons I was able to manage my entire career was the support system that I had. And I was able to recognize that. My mother was a career professional. She retired as the director of All India Radio. All my aunts are professionals in their own right, right? And phenomenal people. My husband was entirely supportive through the journey. His family is reasonably traditional. There's, I think, one lady who works there. But so it was very new, you know, for everyone in that family that here's this lady who's leaving her son in the creche in the factory and going off to work. But I never heard one word that from any of them. So, I mean, I'm eternally grateful for that. So one is that we are not sure and we try and, you know, make ourselves smaller. The second is not relying on support systems that might be available. And the third thing, which I talk about in my book, The Professional Woman's Handbook, is not having a goal for yourself, right? It is only when you decide that, no, my career as a pilot is important to me. You know, it is giving me something nothing else can, and I'm going to pursue it. Once that is clear, everything else falls in place. So I think part of it is socialization. The other thing is not thinking about what is it I want, because it's so easy to compromise if you don't know what you want, right? So that becomes the key.
Right. Having a goal.
Absolutely.
And working towards your goal.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And not settling for anything less.
No.
Perfect. So that's a good takeaway there. All right. So when we're talking about women juggling and women working in new workplaces, there's one very important issue that comes up, and that is sexual harassment. So we have Anupama here, who has been a corporate lawyer for more than 3 decades. And she's written a very nice book. It's called Ready Reckoner on Prevention of Sexual Harassment at Workplaces in India. And she says in that it is not the intention of the perpetrator, but how the victim feels by such gesture or behavior that constitutes sexual harassment. So Anupama, how does this translate to sexual harassment at virtual workplaces now that we have, you know, post-COVID workplaces where people are working from home? How does this translate here, and especially when people are not in, you know, close proximity like they would be in offices?
Yeah,
Thanks a lot, Sajita. A very, very pertinent, important question. In fact, just after the COVID struck, many employers or organizations that I knew of sighed relief, stating that, you know, it becomes a lot more easier now that it's a virtual workplace, there won't be any sexual harassment. Mm-hmm. And that is when it was very important for me to tell people that, you know, there are two aspects to the question you asked. The first one, where we're talking about, it's not the intention of the perpetrator, but how the woman feels. And that is a very important aspect of sexual harassment law that we have in India, because if we decide to go by the intention, then a lot of acts may not amount to sexual harassment. So it is more of how the woman feels, the aggrieved woman feels, that becomes very important to decide whether she has been harassed and she's very uncomfortable about it. Now, when it comes to a virtual workplace, right, if you go to the definition of sexual harassment, it starts from physical contact and advances, demand for sexual favor. And it also talks about showing pornography, any verbal, non-verbal conduct which is of sexual nature. So if you see, most probably by the workplace changing from a physical workplace to a virtual workplace, the only thing that has changed is the fact that there may not be a physical contact or advance. But everything else that we talk about in the definition of a sexual harassment can surely happen even in a virtual workplace. So, for example, if you take up a very a thing that has actually happened with one of my clients, and this happened in the when people were working at physical workplaces. So we had a situation where a guy was constantly sending photographs on WhatsApp of him coming out of the gym with either just his vest on or maybe even that is not on, to show how he's building his body. And the lady was very uncomfortable with what her colleague was doing and finally registered a complaint of sexual harassment. And here we are talking about this can happen even in a virtual situation. So if the lady feels uncomfortable and the situation is not very comfortable for her, it amounts to sexual harassment. His intentions don't matter. And it really doesn't matter whether it's a virtual workplace or a physical workplace.
All right. So we had a lot of discussion happening around Me Too movements, right? So how has the workplace changed after Me Too, Anupama, if you could?
Yes. So I would actually take this question a little differently. I would say, see, the law has come in for women since, you can say 1997, there were guidelines of Supreme Court, which they expected people to abide by. And subsequently in 2013, the act came into force. Now, Me Too is a very different concept, which needs to be differentiated from what has happened at workplace. There is one is a situation where there is a lot of women who complained about being sexually harassed decades later, some of them. And if they have gone making these claims under the Indian Penal Code, where there is no limitation, it's possible to take it up. But if we look at it purely from the perspective of the law that has come in for women, the law is very specific in terms of the period within which you need to make complaints. So something like Me Too, yes, it would have definitely made people aware that they can object to being harassed, but maybe not at such a late stage. So maybe what would have actually helped the women at workplace is to understand that, they need to act on it very soon, and it's not really advisable to sit over it. So I think that's the whole aim of the government bringing in a law which makes it mandatory for awareness trainings, makes it mandatory for, internal committee, the committee which sits for orientation sessions for them, because people need to understand their rights better. And, just a parting thought, 2013, it's 2021 now. And while at the same period, we had the Companies Act, which came into force along with this. Companies Act is completely in force. There are a lot of penalties that are imposed, whereas this act continues to be taking a backseat for the government as well as many organizations.
All right. So Anvita, again, in your glamour industry, talking about Me Too, like what Anupama said, so after this thing came up, a lot of things about casting couch and a lot of issues like that. So has there been any change in the glamour industry? That's a very difficult question to answer, actually, because there is no... The glamour industry is a very vast industry. And if you're just talking about the Bombay industry is very different from the Tamil industry, which is very different from the Telugu industry, which is very different from the Malayalam industry. It's vast. So it's very hard to put it all under one belt. And there's another issue that the fashion industry is actually very different from the film industry. And now the thing about the fashion industry is that most of the people are either women or they are gay. So the people who do get sexually harassed are actually not the women. From my experience, my limited experience in there at least. And unfortunately, the Me Too movement has not touched upon the other gender. And there is still a stigma there. There is still a stigma against speaking out. There's so many people who I know who have been propositioned, and they are men. And the women are speaking out. We're walking up to the press. We're walking up to social media. We're at least speaking out, even if it does not help much legally. We're still speaking out. That's a huge movement. That's a huge change. And that has not happened with men. And that's a huge section of the society that does need to be addressed, at least in the glamour industry, because it is dominated in a certain manner.
Right, right. That's a different perspective there. We never thought of it that way. We are constantly thinking about only women and, you know, their issues.
Sajita, in fact, I'll just take up what she said. You know, a lot of times when I go for these training sessions, many people ask me the question, why is the law only for women and why is it not for the men? And I always tell them that women went to ask for a relief. And if there is a possibility, you think it's important for men also to voice their opinion. And when the government actually came out with this law, in the objects, they made a statement. They thought a lot, came out with a law for just women, but said that it's because women are in minority, but they've left it open for organizations to list out harassments against men so that if they realize that men are being harassed, then they will actually take out a law to support them as well. But what's very important is men also need to express themselves.
Absolutely, yeah. They do. Yeah. And that's something that's not happening as much.
Right. So the men here have noted that.
Yeah.
All right. So talking about men now, we are talking like when all of us are sitting here. So what you probably see here is some empowered women sitting here. Right. So women are getting empowered. So how are the men changing? Are the men also changing? So I think probably share some humorous anecdotes wherein the men took charge of the kitchen or maybe did some chores and helped you out while you were in your high flying careers. So yes, I think we'll go with you, Manisha, first.
Yes, I would say men are changing, and the mindset has also changed. They are accepting women in all roles, including being professional. And you know, we are all leading a career which definitely is very, very demanding. And without the support of our husbands, we would have probably not been flying so high. And yes, my husband did pitch in and used to look after the girls when I'm on night flight. And since this profession is, you know, with machines, I mean, I take off, I have to come back within 4 hours, aircraft get grounded anywhere. I may get stuck, not arrive until next day, but the house and the family has to go on. The kids have to go to school. The homework has to be done and all those various things. So yes, men did pitch in. And our generation, I think, took the start because I have seen my father not doing anything. As a child, when I grew up, my mom would handle everything. And though we looked up to our dad and, you know, he was an educator, he was director of education and all that. But we thought that was the done deal. But as we grew up and as I got into this profession, I realized, no, men need to pitch in. And so it did work. And even in the profession, I would say, during the course of the time when we joined into the airlines, there used to be one girl per, batch. They were not inducting more than one. For a very, very long time. And we were grateful that they started inducting one. And thanks to the first girl who broke the glass ceiling in 1966, when she got inducted in Indian Airlines. And I'm sure half of you were not even born at that time. And people don't know that girls have been flying since 1966 in India, and Indian Airlines, the only domestic airlines, was the one that gave them the chance. And we've seen the change in the men's attitude towards us when we were flying during those time, from the 70s, 80s, till mid-90s and late 90s, we felt that, you know, you're not welcomed. But we gave them no choice. We performed. We did well. Each one of us got a command. So, you know, though we had to put in 110%, more than 100% to prove us, even if we were par excellent, we were termed at below average, because they wanted to feel that whatever the factor, this is male's domain, male's profession. This is male dominated work, but it's not so. Like in my book, I have clearly mentioned, pilot has no gender. If you pick up any dictionary in the world, pilot has no gender. And sure enough, machine doesn't know who is touching the machine. If I perform well, whether it's a male hand or a female, it will perform. If I'm messing it up, it's anyway mess up. So a profession like ours taught us that, yes, but through the mid-90s and late 90s, we felt a change in the men accepting women in the cockpit. The whole scenario changed. Women were welcome. There were more girls getting in today. We still stand number one in the world with maximum percentage of women flying as commanders across all fields. We are 22%, whereas world over it's only 7%. So here also we have proved, and men in India, I think, has accepted much better, and people outside also. So yes, there has been a change and empowerment for me. And I think for all women, empowerment is not giving us programs for empowerment. It is the mindset change. It is the society change. That is the empowerment, to accepting women in all roles, whether personal or professional. That's empowerment. That's what we want. That's what every generation would want. And I think it is happening. That I want to just add in the Me Too movement here, which started. And, you know, even in aviation, there's so much rumors of men's being, women have to go through, and unfortunately, a lot of cabin crew have to go through a lot of shit. But even women pilots initially, and because there were very, very few number, we were 8-9 of us in the 80s and 90s across 800 pilots. So you can imagine the percentage. But you have to just stand with your head up and let them know where to draw the line. And I think if you're strong enough, that works, really works. And during the earlier course, and I think most and all of the women flying with us have really proved it that way. And that is all I could say.
So the men have been the wind beneath the wings, especially now your husband has been the wind beneath your wings. So Aparna, would you like to probably add to that?
Yeah, most definitely. You know, support systems are extremely, extremely important. Without that, it's not possible. And you said, you know, can you remember anything funny? And I remember my husband and I we used to work in a factory kind of setup and go early in the morning, come back, you know, evening-ish. Luckily, that was way before mobile phones and laptops. So once we came home, that's it. Yeah. But what I would do was, I said, okay, I'll handle the kitchen and you take care of our son. And many times, I remember one time distinctly where he said, yeah, I'll play with him. You don't worry. You handle whatever. I'll take care of him. And I went, finished dinner, and I went in to check on them, and I'm seeing my son is wide awake and husband is fast asleep. And I have a photograph of that to prove that happens. But support does exist. Yeah. The one thing that is still required, though, is a shift in our own mindset. Yeah. Because we need to understand and vocalize that it's not about men pitching in or helping us. Yeah, they're doing their share of what is a joint effort of, you know, building a family, right? So Of course, I'm grateful, and all of us should be, because we wouldn't be here without that. However, these are roles we play, you know. So for a man, if a man gets married and wants to have children, then they are equally the child of the husband and the wife. Yeah, so as long as we have this sense in our minds that housework is mine, plus my, you know, regular outside work is also mine, then we're going to have that difficulty. So that somewhere needs to shift as well.
So women need to understand that aspect. And yeah. All right. So we are left with now 10 minutes, and we would like to take questions from you all. The panelists will take questions. I think you'll have to move to the mic.
I worked as a senior superintendent in NGEF, it's a factory, state-owned public sector industry. And we had a very good medical reimbursement scheme for our grade. Everybody had according to their grade. So when my husband met with an accident, I applied for medical reimbursement. And they said the husband is not dependent on the wife economically. So they refused to reimburse. But when I had a medical problem in his office, they could give, because the wife is always dependent on the husband, no matter if I'm earning more than my husband. And then my mother had an operation. When I applied for it, they said a married woman, a mother is not dependent on a married daughter. So they said we cannot reimburse. Because in case if I had to take reimbursement for her medical care, I had to get a declaration from all the sons and daughters saying that they have abandoned the mother and that she is only dependent on me. And the others, we were a very big family. So they didn't do. Then my mother-in-law had to undergo an operation. So I went and applied for it. They said a mother-in-law, a daughter-in-law cannot claim for a mother-in-law. So I said, okay, I am a senior superintendent, and the guy sitting next to me is claiming for his wife, though she is working in a place and earning more than him. Without a question, they were reimbursing his bills. And then I said, then what can I? He said, you can only claim for yourself and your children.
So ma'am, what is the question that you would ask the panelists, please? Yeah.
I wanted to ask, is that the same situation in the pilot aviation industry or in other industries where these kind of rules, you know, does it happen? Can you claim for your husband's medical treatment in your office?
Since Air India is public limited and owned by the government, so it was semi-government. And when we joined Indian Airlines, it was the government airlines. Yes, during that course, your spouse and children, you could claim, you would get medical benefit for them, and you would also get flying tickets for your spouse. And so being a woman, my spouse being my husband, even though if he was earning less or more, it didn't matter. Now, after you retire, it only goes medical to your spouse, but parents can claim, but not my in-laws. So that those kind of rules are set in. And I don't know about the other industry with...
Yeah, I think, I was in HR for like a really long time. And I think there's some relaxation now that it's not as strict, but in-laws is, yeah. As far as I was working, it was still not covered now.
See what your earnings from each partner.
No, they don't. They don't.
Just
yeah.
Your spouse. So if
that's
you're
right.
A woman, your spouse becomes your husband. If you're a male, your spouse becomes your.
The question in general, active question. Do you think it's unfair that as women professionals, we are always compared to how we are domestically, as in not viewed independently as a professionals, whereas males don't have that burden. So when you look at, like, for example, Linda Louis's book. They need to mention that when she's a CEO or any woman professional, it's always like, how is she as a mother? There's always a question. There's always like a query on domestically, is she as successful in her marriage, in her, you know, as a mother, as a parent? Is that, you know, when men don't have that burden, isn't that very unfair? And we need to move away from fusing the domestic as well as professional responsibility together for women especially, which men don't seem to have at all.
Completely agree with you. And I'm reminded of the Prime Minister of UK. So his wife is having his second child after he became the Prime Minister. And I was just thinking when I saw that news, what would have happened if he had been a woman? You know, and it was her second pregnancy. The whole world would have gone nuts. Yeah, so double standards do exist. Yeah, but I think it's a question of choosing what you allow yourself as an individual to get affected by. Because there's just a lot of stuff going on in the world. You know, this is one example of it, but there's so much going on. Just like put blinkers on and move on, I guess. Easier said than done. I mean, but
yeah, I think. And I would just add in there, yes, it is the mindset change required. You need to have a mindset. And like the education system itself, from the beginning, the children have to be men, women, doesn't matter. You need to be what you are. You need to do what you want to, and the society have to accept that. I sincerely feel that the mindset of every individual has to change. And yes, you're absolutely right. And just adding that little bit here, in the book, if you pick up From Saris to Stripe, you will realize that none of the men go through what we go through as women pilots, because we have to report sick the day we conceive. We get to know we are expecting. We have to report sick and for 9 months plus 3 months after the baby is born. But male captain doesn't. He's still a father, but he doesn't need to. So after the course of that, we have to go through the entire process of retraining, which takes us more than 1 year to come back into the cockpit. So guys don't go through that at all. They just enjoying every benefit of it, but that is life. But women handle it. But mindset need to change.
Yes, mindset needs to change. And thank you all the panelists, and thank you audience for being a wonderful audience. Thank you.